Problem 15. Two blocks of masses m and 3m are interconnected by an ideal undeformed spring of stiffness k. A constant horizontal pull force starts acting on the lighter block as shown, and the magnitude of this horizontal force is F. The horizontal surface is frictionless and the spring massless. In part A, working in a reference frame fixed to 3m, find the maximum elongation of the spring during the process of motion. So in part A, we will assume that the observer who's watching the motion of the other block is fixed to the frame of 3m. Let x be the elongation of the spring, then the tensile force in the spring would be kx at any moment, so that the free body diagrams of the two blocks will be as shown. On the block of mass 3m, the force acting towards the right would be kx, while if this block has an acceleration a towards the right, then for this observer, the pseudo force on this block will be towards the left and in magnitude equal to 3m times a. So this acceleration is acceleration of 3m in the earth frame. Now for this observer, 3m has no acceleration in the relative frame, so that the forces in the horizontal direction will be balanced. So kx will be equal to 3m times a. And this will give us a equal to kx by 3m. Next we consider the free body diagram of the other block, once again including the pseudo force for this observer. Now on the smaller block of mass m, the pseudo force would be acting towards the left and equal to m into a in magnitude, and then let the relative acceleration of the smaller block with respect to 3m be equal to a rel, and this we are considering to be positive towards the right. So for small m in the horizontal direction, including the pseudo force also, Newton's second law becomes F minus kx minus ma is equal to m times a rel. But what is the value of ma from this equation? Ma will be kx by 3. So this will become F minus kx minus kx by 3 equal to m times a rel. Or this becomes F minus 4kx by 3 is equal to m times a rel, which can be written as dv rel by dt, and then using the chain rule we can write this as dv rel by dx into dx by dt. Now what is the distance of m with respect to 3m, or the distance between the two blocks? This will be the natural length of the spring plus the elongation x. So clearly, if we want to know what is the value of the relative velocity of mass m with respect to 3m, then this would be the derivative of the distance between the two with respect to time. But L naught is a constant, so this is simply equal to x dot, which means in this expression dx by dt can be written as v rel itself. Therefore, we will obtain F minus 4k by 3 into x is equal to m times v rel into dv rel by dx. Now we can rearrange the terms and form an integral, m integral of v rel into dv rel should be equal to integral of f dx minus integral of 4k by 3 into x dx, and the limits we have to choose carefully so that we are able to solve the question. Now look at the question of part A once again. Working in a reference frame fixed to 3m, find the maximum elongation of the spring during the process of motion. So we have to find the maximum value of x. Now we have already seen earlier that VREL is the same as x dot. So the instant when x becomes maximum, at that moment, from maximum and minimum of calculus, x dot is going to be 0 or VREL is going to be 0. And what was the value of VREL in the beginning when the motion just started? Well, in the beginning, both blocks had 0 initial velocity, so VREL was clearly 0. And in the beginning, the value of x was 0 because the spring was initially in its natural state. So now we can put the limits of this integral when in the beginning x was 0, VREL was 0, and after some time when x attains its maximum value, at that moment VREL again becomes 0. So this will give us m times the integral of VREL into dVREL is VREL square by 2, but both limits are 0, so we will just have 0. And this should be equal to, f is a constant, into integral of dx is x, so that would give us x max minus 0 minus 4k by 3 is a constant, it comes out of the integral, and integral of x dx is x square by 2, so we will have x max square by 2 minus 0 square by 2. And finally, the non-zero value of x which we get from this equation will be 3f by 2k. And of course, there is one more root of this equation, and that is x equal to 0. Now that corresponds to the minimum value of x, because notice one thing, that whether x is maximum or minimum, VREL is going to be 0 from maximum and minima. So the two roots of this equation correspond to the minimum and maximum values of x, namely the minimum value is 0 while the maximum value is 3f by 2k. So 3f by 2k is a maximum elongation of the spring during the process of motion. In part B, we are asked to repeat the same problem by working in a reference frame fixed to m. Now this you can try on your own. Of course, the answer must be the same, 3f by 2k. Now in the B part, you will have to attach your observer on the smaller block and assume its acceleration to be a, and then draw the free body diagram of the bigger block showing the pseudo force, and work in a similar way, taking care to use the chain rule with VREL equal to x dot. Problem 16. In the figure shown, a constant horizontal force F equal to mg root 2 starts acting on the block of mass m. So the mass of this block is m, and the force has a constant magnitude of mg root 2. The spring is undeformed in the position shown and has a natural length L. Its spring constant has a value equal to 3 mg by 2L. So the spring constant K has a value equal to 3 mg by 2L. The floor is frictionless. What will be the velocity of the block at the moment when it loses contact with the floor? So let x be the displacement of the block till any moment until it has lost contact with the floor. So for the diagram shown, the block is still in contact with the floor. Then x will be equal to L tan theta, where theta is this angle. Now if the natural length of the spring is L, then the new length is going to be L secant theta, so that the elongation of the spring will be L secant theta minus L. Look at the free body diagram of the block while it is still moving horizontally, touching the floor. The force is acting on the right and it has a constant magnitude of mg root 2. Its weight is acting downwards while normal reaction is acting upwards. And then the tension in the spring equal to k delta, where delta is L secant theta minus L. This acts on the block, making an angle theta with the vertical, because this angle here is theta. Now at the moment of contact loss, the normal reaction will just become equal to 0. Now till this moment, the block is moving horizontally, so it has no component of acceleration in the vertical direction. As a result, we can balance the forces in the vertical direction and write k delta into cos theta plus normal reaction should be equal to the weight of the block mg. And if normal reaction just goes to 0, then at this moment, k delta delta is itself L into secant theta minus 1, this whole thing into cos theta just equals mg. Now what is the value of k? K is 3mg by 2L. So k into L would become 3mg by 2 into secant theta into cos theta is 1, and then we will have minus cos theta. Now we can cancel mg and mg also to obtain 2 is equal to 3 minus 3 cos theta, or at the instant of contact loss, cos theta will be 1 by 3. And in case we are interested in finding tan theta, then if this is theta, cos theta is 1 by 3. So this must be 1, this must be 3. So that from Pythagoras' theorem, the perpendicular of this imaginary triangle will be 3 square is 9, 9 minus 1 under root is 2 root 2, or square root of 8, which means tan theta will be 2 root 2 upon 1, or just 2 root 2. Now from the beginning till this moment of contact loss, let us apply the work energy theorem on this entire system. The system consists of the spring and the block. Now on this system, what are the external forces? One is the external force exerted by the ceiling at the upper end of the spring, but this force is not doing any work because the upper end of the spring is fixed, or its displacement is zero. What about the normal reaction exerted on the block from the floor? Even that is not doing any work because the displacement is horizontal while the normal reaction is vertically up. And the same is the case for mg, or the weight of the block. So the only external force doing work on the system is the force F, and the spring force acting on the block is an internal force of the system. So we apply the work energy theorem on the system, according to which the work done by the external force F will be equal to the change in the mechanical energy of the system. And in this system, the mechanical energy is the spring's potential energy and the block's kinetic energy. Notice that the block's potential energy does not come into the picture because the potential energy is not changing at all. So applying the work energy theorem on the system, between the moments x equal to 0 and x equal to L tan theta, at the instant when tan theta is 2 root 2, which will become 2 L root 2, the moment of contact loss, we have work done by the external force F, which will be equal to the constant force F times the displacement of the point of application of this force F. Now, the block is moving towards the right by a distance x, which is equal to 2 L root 2 till the contact loss moment. So clearly, this force whose magnitude is mg root 2 will do a work equal to F into x, which will be mg root 2 into 2L root 2, or this will be 4MgL, and this should be equal to delta kinetic energy of the block plus delta U spring, the change in the potential energy of the spring. So we have 4MgL on the left hand side, and on the right hand side we have change in kinetic energy of the block, that is half m v square, and this v is the speed of the block at the instant of contact loss, or at the moment when the normal reaction just becomes zero, plus the spring's potential energy at the beginning was zero because the spring was in its natural position, and now the spring has a potential energy equal to half k delta square. But what is k? K is given to be 3mg by 2L, while delta at this moment of contact loss will be L into secant theta minus 1. But what is secant theta? Secant theta is the inverse of cos theta, that is 3. So we have L into 3 minus 1, or 2L. This is the elongation of the spring. So the right hand side of the work energy theorem becomes mv square by 2 plus k delta square by 2 would give us 3mg by 2 into 2 is 4L, into delta square would be 4L square. Finally, we obtain mv square equal to 4mgl minus 3mgl, which is just equal to mgl, so that the speed of the block at the instant of contact loss will be square root of 2gl. The This is the required answer. Problem 17. In the figure shown on the right, the friction coefficient between block of mass 1 kg and the floor is half. The block is not connected with the spring, but only pressing against it. The stiffness of the spring is 1000 Newton per meter. The spring is initially compressed by 20 cm or 0.2 meter from its natural position when the block is released. So at the instant when the block is released, the spring is already compressed by 0.2 meters. What total distance will the block travel on the rough floor? Now let our system be the block plus spring, and we'll apply the work energy theorem on the system between position A and B, where this is position A and this is position B. In position B, the block has traveled a total distance x and come to rest, while in position A, the spring was initially compressed by 0.2 meter and the block was just released from rest. Now on this system, the external forces are normal reaction on the block, which is not doing any work, the force of gravity on the block, which is also not doing any work, and then the force exerted by the wall at the left end of the spring out here. Even this is not doing any work because the left end of the spring is static. So the only external force on this system doing work will be the force of kinetic friction, whose work is going to be negative. Now, as the block moves horizontally, the normal reaction will be equal to its weight, and since its mass is given to be 1 kg, its weight will be 10 newtons. As a result, the value of normal reaction is just going to be equal to 10 newtons itself. And as the block moves towards the right by some distance x, the force of kinetic friction will be constant, and acting towards the left, it will be mu into n. Mu is given to be half, while normal reaction is 10. So this will come out to be equal to 5 newtons. So the force of kinetic friction acting opposite to the displacement is constant in magnitude and equal to 5 newtons. Therefore, on the system, the work energy theorem gives work done by kinetic friction force equal to change in the energy of the system. Now this system has two kind of energies. One is the spring's potential energy, while the other is the block's kinetic energy. And we are applying this work energy equation between A and B. Now if the block travels a total distance x, then the work done by the friction force is minus 5 into x. Minus sign is coming because the force of friction is opposite to the displacement, so because of cos of 180 degrees. And on the right hand side, we have change in kinetic energy of the system, that is the change in the kinetic energy of the block, plus the change in the spring potential energy. Now the block was initially released from rest, so in position A, its speed is 0, and in position B, it has finally come to rest. So once again, VB is 0, so that the initial kinetic energy as well as the final kinetic energy, that is just 0, plus the change in the energy of the spring. Now in state B, the spring is just in its natural state because the block has lost contact with the spring and now come to state B. So the final energy in the spring is 0, while the initial energy was half into k is 1000 into initial compression in the spring was 0.2 meter, so 0.2 square. Or this is equal to minus of 20. And we are working in the MK system, so x will come out to be in meters. We get x equal to 4 meters. This is the answer. So what will actually happen is, the block will first travel to the right because of the compression in the spring, and it will first travel a distance of 20 centimeters, after which the spring will come in its natural position, but the block would have acquired some velocity. So because of that momentum, it will continue moving on the right, but the force of kinetic friction will continuously retard it. So the block finally comes to rest after traveling a further distance of 3.8 meters. So that is why the total distance traveled is 0.2 plus 3.8 equal to 4 meters. Problem 18. In the figure shown, the mass of the upper disc is m and that of the lower disc is 2m. The spring constant is k. The upper disc is depressed down by a distance equal to delta from its equilibrium position and released. Now, let this be the natural position of the spring, or let this be the height of the upper disc at the instant when the spring is in its natural position. Then, from its natural position, because of the weight of the upper disc will be at equilibrium in this position, where the compression in the spring would be x. Now, this will be such that the compressive force in the spring equal to kx is able to balance the weight of the upper disc mg. So, this is the condition for the equilibrium of the upper disc, which implies x will be equal to mg by k. Now, from its equilibrium position, the upper disc is further depressed down by a distance equal to delta, and say it comes to this position, so that the spring gets compressed a total distance of x plus delta from its natural position. In this position, this disc is just released from rest. So at this moment, its velocity is just equal to zero. We call this state of the system as state B. Now, after the upper disc is released, the spring is going to expand or try to regain its natural position. So the upper disc is going to rise. Now, by the time the spring reaches its natural position, the upper disc would have acquired some upward velocity also, so that it is going to overshoot and keep rising higher up. Let y be the elongation of the spring measured from its natural position, and let the velocity of the upper disc at this moment be equal to v. Now, in part A, we have to find the values of delta for which the lower disc will rise above the ground. Now, let the normal reaction exerted by the floor on the lower disc be n. So, this is the free body diagram of the lower disc. The normal reaction acting is n, while the weight of the lower disc 2mgx downwards. And if the spring is elongated by a distance y, then the tensile force in the spring equal to ky acts upwards on the lower disc. In fact, it is this force of ky which is going to cause the lower disc to rise up. Now, if you just want to find the critical value of delta for which the lower disc will rise, then we just analyze the moment when the normal reaction on the lower disc is just equal to zero. Let that situation be situation C of the system. Or another way to look at part A would be that lower disc is going to rise if the tensile force in the spring trying to pull it up is greater than its own weight, which is 2mg. Or we can reframe this condition and write that if at y equal to 2mg by k, the velocity of the upper disc happens to be non-zero, then the upper disc is going to keep rising up and elongating the spring. As a result, y is going to definitely exceed the value of 2mg by k, and the lower disc is going to rise up. So we work in terms of this condition. After the upper disc is released from rest in state B, then in going from state B to state C, there is no external force acting on the system other than the normal reaction from the floor and the gravity forces acting on the two discs. Now, this normal reaction is not doing any work while the system goes from state B to state C. And the work of gravity forces is anyway taken on the right hand side of the work energy equation in terms of the gravitational potential energy. So, in the absence of any other force except gravity doing work on the system, we can conserve the total mechanical energy of the system, where the system is the two discs and the spring. So, we conserve the mechanical energy of the system between states B and C. Now, let us write the mechanical energy of the system in state B. Notice one thing, that the lower disc is not going to change its altitude between B and C. So, its potential energy is not really going to matter. So, we just discard the potential energy of the lower disc. But what about the upper disc? If we take this state to be the datum for the upper disc, then its potential energy in this state can be taken to be zero, while the potential energy in this state C would be equal to mg into this height gained, which will be equal to y plus x plus delta. So we write the mechanical energy of the system in state B. The spring is compressed from its natural position by an amount x plus delta. So the energy would be half k into x plus delta whole square. And the kinetic energy of the upper disc is zero, while its potential energy, we are assuming it to be zero in state B. So there is no other energy possessed by the system in state B. What about state C? In state C, the upper disc has a kinetic energy also, which is half mv square. Plus, the upper disc has acquired a potential energy also equal to mg into the total height gained is delta plus x plus y. And the spring also has some energy in state C. What is the elongation of the spring in state C from its natural position? It is y. So that will be half k y square. And we have to equate these two energies by conserving mechanical energy of the system. So let us look at this equation in detail, putting x equal to mg by k. So in this energy equation, we put x equal to mg by k, and then from this condition, we put y equal to 2mg by k. So the value of mv square by 2 comes out to be k by 2 into x plus delta whole square is mg by k plus delta whole square minus this entire term, which will give us delta plus x is mg by k, and for y we have to put 2mg by k minus this term k by 2 y square, or k by 2 into 2mg by k whole square. So we first open this bracket and we get these three terms, and then this becomes minus of mg delta, which will cancel with this also, minus m square g square by k, and there will be another term corresponding to this, minus 2m square g square by k. So this becomes minus 3m square g square by k, minus the last term would give us 2m square g square by k. Finally, we get mv square by 2 equal to k by 2 delta square, and the rest of the terms just give one term, which is minus 9m square g square by 2k. And from this initial condition, we should have v greater than 0 if you want the lower disc to lose contact with the ground. So v greater than 0 implies this thing should be greater than 0 for 2m to rise above the ground. So this will give us delta should be greater than square root of 9m square g square by k square. 2 and 2 get cancelled, so that would be 3mg by k. So this is the required answer, or delta should be greater than 3mg by k if we want the lower disc to rise above the ground. Next is part B. If delta is 5mg by k, what will be the upward velocity of the upper disc when the lower disc is just about to lose contact with the floor? Now the lower disc will be just about to lose contact with the floor when the value of y is just equal to 2mg by k. So in our energy equation, we put y equal to 2mg by k and solve for the value of v. Of course, we have to put delta equal to 5mg by k. So in this equation, we put delta equal to 5mg by k, which is given to us, and y equal to 2mg by k, and solve for the value of v. Note that x is mg by k. So the first term is k by 2 into x, which is mg by k, plus delta, which is given to be 5mg by k whole square. This will be equal to 1 plus 5 is 6, so 36 by 2 into m square g square by k square, and then there is 1k in the numerator, so just 1k is left in the denominator, and this should be equal to mv square by 2, v is what we are interested in finding in part b, plus delta plus x plus y. Delta is 5 mg by k, x is 1 mg by k, while y is 2 mg by k at this moment when the lower disc is just about to rise. So 5 plus 1 is 6, and 6 plus 2 is 8. So this term becomes 8 m square g square by k, plus the last term would be k y square by 2, and y is 2 mg by k. So this will become 2 m square g square by k. Now 36 by 2 is 18. 18 minus 8 would be 10, and 10 minus 2 would be 8. So we get 8 m square g square by k equal to mv square by 2, or v, the velocity of the upper disc at the instant when the lower disc is just about to lose contact with the floor, will be 4g into m by k under root. This is the answer.